Good morning. Welcome to this first Sunday of Christmas across the Mission Partnership. For those of you who've not met me before, my name is Ned. Welcome. And thank you for joining us for this special worship service. Through Advent, I was helping us to and encouraging us to see the season of Advent a bit like the season of Lent. And like Lent, and it being followed by Easter, so Advent is followed by Christmas, and so often we see Christmas and Easter in a similar way. We see it as a one-day event, when in fact, it's the start of a whole season. And with Easter, it matches in length, almost exactly, the amount of time we spend in Lent. The preparation time is matched in equal measure by the celebration time. The same could be seen with Advent and Christmas, if you include Epiphany as well, which is an extension of the celebration of Christmas. This white season is of equal length, if not a little longer, than the season of purple, the preparation. And so today, I want us just to bear that in mind as we celebrate Christmas, that for many of us, Christmas was more simple, more stripped back, and less of a ta-da moment as it usually is. Many traditions having to change or be discarded. But the great news about the season is, even if the pandemic desires to stop it, Christmas is not cancelled. We continue to celebrate whether we are feeling it and whether the world joins us in that or not. We as Christians are called to proclaim the Christmas message from now on in this season. We focus on it and we celebrate it. And so today, we're going to explore something of the Nativity story, going back over, maybe you've heard it many times over the last few days, but we're going to go back over, particularly focusing in on the shepherds and what they are asked to do to find Jesus, in their case, in Bethlehem. And Murray's going to help us to explore that theme as we head into this Christmas season and particularly into 2021 with whatever that year holds. Before we begin, I'm going to light our Advent wreath, as I said I would do, because we did light the Christmas candle on Christmas Sunday, Christmas Day, and then we sort of, well, I have historically packed it away, ready for the next Advent, but actually, I think it's really important to have it lit through the Christmas season, even if it is just one Sunday. There we go. So the Christmas lights will be lit throughout the rest of this service. As we come into the Christmas season, we bring with it our Advent repentance, asking as we seek Jesus, as we seek to find him in our lives, to acknowledge those places where he may have been hidden by sin, that we, in our sin and our brokenness, have turned away from him and we're looking in the wrong place. If we are going to find Jesus, we need to turn and face him. So, the Sun of Righteousness has dawned with healing in his wings. Let us come to the light of Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. So let us just take a few moments of quiet to reflect on the sin that hides us from Jesus and in our hearts turn to him afresh. The words will be on the bottom of the screen. There is a repeated refrain through these confessions, as I say, on the bottom of a screen. Lord of grace and truth, we confess our unworthiness to stand in your presence as children. We have sinned. Forgive and heal us. The Virgin Mary accepted your call to be the mother of Jesus. Forgive our disobedience to your will. We have sinned. Forgive and heal us. Your Son, our Saviour, was born in poverty in a manger. Forgive our greed and rejection of your ways. We have sinned. Forgive and heal us. The shepherds left their flocks to go to Bethlehem. Forgive our self-interest and lack of vision. We have sinned. Forgive and heal us. The wise men followed the star to find Jesus the King. Forgive our reluctance to seek you. We have sinned. Forgive and heal us. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw you to himself and cleanse you from all your sins, that you may behold the glory of his Son, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to sing our first carol today, and that's While Shepherds Watched Their Flocks by Night. Steve will read to us in just a moment. It's from Luke's Gospel, chapter 2. But before we do, I'm going to just acclaim our Gospel reading. We don't usually do this, but I thought it would be helpful for us as we get ready to listen to this wonderful good news of the angels to the shepherds and to ourselves. Alleluia, alleluia. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Alleluia.
Hello. Today's reading is taken from Luke chapter 2, verses 15 to 21. So it was, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard them marvelled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told them. And when 8 days were completed for the circumcision of the child, his name was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. This is the word of the Lord.
Loving God, as the shepherds set off to Bethlehem to search for Jesus, help us to think how and where we find Jesus and expect to find him in this new year to come. For his name's sake. Amen. We heard that they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. And I want us to think about what went on when the shepherds were searching out Jesus. How did they find him? Where did they look? What sort of places did they look for Jesus, and amongst what sort of people? The angel who'd appeared to them on the hills gave the shepherds some pretty clear hints, but he hadn't given them an address and a postcode. The message was, do not be afraid. Need to hear those words. Do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Saviour, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. I think the first clue that I had that you could find Jesus where you might not expect to find him came to me in my teens when I heard about the work of Mother Teresa in Calcutta, when she found Jesus in the desperately poor people that she and her order worked amongst. And there were clues for the shepherds that they should look in a similar sort of place. The baby would be lying in a manger. Now that meant that the parents couldn't even afford a crib for their baby. They were having to make do with an animal's feeding trough. There would have been, more well-to-do people living in Bethlehem at the time, but the shepherds would not find Jesus amongst them. I wonder if you thought how you could find Jesus and whether you could find him amongst those who have the least in our society, that somehow standing alongside those people, you would meet Jesus. So how might you do that? What would that lead you to doing? I suppose once I realised that Jesus could be found in sort of unexpected places, I looked at my life and thought, well, where did I expect to find Jesus? I think the most natural answer for many years would be that I found Jesus in worship. And that would have been that amazing feeling, that experience of Jesus' presence that I found in the glorious songs of the charismatic movement that I grew up with, well, from my teenage years, grew up with. And they're, of course, reflected in the more contemporary songs that we enjoy today. In the Christmas story, the search for Jesus is prompted by worship. The shepherds are sent on their way by an angelic chorus. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace amongst those whom he favours. And when the shepherds return to their sheep and the hills, they were joining in that worship, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. We do find Jesus in worship. Today, for me, my perspective is broader. I appreciate a greater range of music styles. I have grown to love the liturgy of the church, the words of the services that we use. When I was not well, it was the liturgy that carried me when I couldn't even cope really with engaging with the preaching. And particular prayers have become deeply, deeply important to me. I use them each day in my prayer times, and saying those prayers is so important in connecting me with Jesus, or reconnecting me with Jesus each day. Another important part of worship are the sacraments. Over the years, I have particularly come to sense the significance of meeting Jesus in bread and wine. And I find that it's not something that I can find rationally. But when I sort of let go of my tendency to analyse and think things through, when I just receive from God, Jesus is powerfully present in the sacraments. Along with many others, I'm also finding God more in the natural world. And I mention that now because I think I find God in a similar sort of way to I find him in the sacraments. It's not by analysing the trees or the hills particularly, I used to be a geologist. It is by seeing things in a sort of softer focus, just gazing at the wild hills of Derbyshire or the trees in the woods that I walk in. And allowing the glory of God to catch me somehow out of the corner of my eye. It's not something I've really worked out how to express, but it's something like that. And of course, the Bible has been another really important place where I find Jesus. In the Christmas story, it's sort of less so for the shepherds, more so for the wise men who are directed to Bethlehem by the words of the prophet Micah. For me, all through my Christian life, my life of faith, I've experienced God speaking to me and making Jesus real to me through the words of Scripture, and that's been hugely important. It's always sort of happened from time to time as I've read the Bible day by day. Words just suddenly light up from the page as I'm sure many of you will have found. More recently, I've discovered that, of course, the church has been refining ways of doing this for centuries and gives us ways of contemplating and meditating on scripture, which I'm now tapping into and finding very helpful, particularly the Ignatian way of approaching the Bible and Lectio Divina, slow reading of meditating on scripture. So that the Bible reading and prayer sort of merge. Am I reading a passage or praying a passage? It's somewhere between the two. Which brings me to prayer, which may not feature strongly in the Christmas story, but is never far away. It is, of course, the most immediate and obvious way for us to connect with Jesus. The way we have of opening up to God and of God speaking to us. We have this way of speaking words or thinking thoughts which are to God, addressed to God, which brings us into a profound personal way of communicating with God, of talking and listening to God, being in the presence of God in a way which is transforming and sort of guides and directs our lives. We see the life of prayer in the lives of Mary and Joseph. They would not react the way they do if they were not people of prayer. Mary especially, in the way she responds to the angel right at the start of the story. Mary says, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." That response, amazing response of open acceptance, which is at the heart of prayer. Ready to go with the strange, dangerous and amazing ways of God, which demand a level of trust and faith that can only be sustained through prayer. And Joseph likewise. And prayerful contemplation is expressed in this passage as Mary responds to the account of the shepherd, and then as she treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. She was almost doing a Lectio Divina on the words of the shepherds, contemplating, meditating on those words. And then she and Joseph are obedient to the angel's instruction and name their child Jesus. So in this passage, the shepherds were spurred on by the message and the worship of the angels. They found Jesus in the poor and vulnerable circumstances in Bethlehem, as the Bible lays out. And their experience of Jesus led them to return glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. As it had been told them. Funny way of expressing it, but that's what the passage says. As it had been told them. So, what about you? Where will you find Jesus in the new year which is coming? Maybe you'll hear it in a dog barking like my dog is. Perhaps you need to broaden your expectation a bit of where to look for Jesus, where you will find Jesus. And perhaps you will be led to experiencing him in new and different ways. Maybe ways I haven't even thought of. But I think most of all, you will are likely to find Jesus in the ways that you have found him before. So take a moment to think back. Where are you accustomed to finding Jesus? Because I think that's where you'll find him particularly. Yes, even in the upheaval and upset of this horrendous year, Jesus will have been present, unexpectedly present, I would suggest. Where will that be for you? For Jesus is to be found in suffering and difficulty as much as joy and delight. The two are so often mingled, as in the Christmas story. The light is found alongside the dark. May we, with eyes and hearts open and expectant, look forward to finding and greeting Jesus in all the ups and downs of this year which is to come, so that we may glorify and praise God for all we hear and see. Amen.
Thank you, Murray, for that really helpful and quite practical sermon there, talking about how we might engage with Jesus in worship, in our familiar worship, and maybe even experimenting a little. So whatever you need to take from that, I really encourage you to make a note of that, a bit of like a New Year's resolution, perhaps. We're going to turn now to our prayers of intercession, and Joy's going to lead us in that. She is outside, and so the sound is a little quiet. I've tried to boost it a little bit, but you may need to strain a little bit to hear her. But I hope that she will lead us well in prayer.
Good morning, everybody. So I just wanted to reflect on finding Jesus at this time. So it can be really hard sometimes at Christmas with all the busyness of everything happening, and especially this year with all the changes and plans having to be made and remade. So let's try and find each day some space to just give some time to God and to find Jesus, even in the busyness and even in everything that's going on, just to find Jesus. And where I find Jesus is coming out for a walk, just coming out and looking at his creation, looking at the beautiful skies. So let's pray. Thank you, Lord, that we can find you in any situation in our lives, even when times are stressful, even when things are difficult. Help us try and find you and look for you in every situation, and that we would give time and space for you to speak to us. And this Christmas time, I pray that we would use this time to draw near to you, and that whatever happens and whatever's going to come in the coming year, that we would learn to trust you and look to you in all things. Amen.
Thank you, Joy. We're coming to the end of our service now. And before we sing our final carol and receive the blessing and get dismissed into this Christmas season, just a few notices. The Alpha begins in the new year across the Mission Partnership. Maybe this Christmas has challenged your faith a little, or maybe there is someone who has been asking questions over Zoom, a family Zoom perhaps. They've been asking questions about the Christian faith and its place within the modern world. These are the sorts of questions that are tackled in Alpha. So do go to the St. Chad's Wood Seats website And it's prominently advertised on there. So do book your place and make your way down. Or as I say, friends or family members who may be asking questions. It's all been done online. So geography is not a restriction any longer. So do consider sharing that with anyone for whom that might be helpful. Life is going back to normal now, with normal patterns of worship, but obviously we're still in COVID time, so normal as it might be at this time. In 2021, we don't know what the future holds. We don't know what each month looks like. This is being recorded before Christmas Day, so I don't know what's changing, but it seems to be changing every day. All I can suggest to you, and I really strongly encourage you this new year, to look at the websites of the different churches and indeed the Facebook pages. You may need to do a little bit extra work in getting involved and following up on the information. So do not be afraid to ask the question. If you don't understand or you don't know where things are or whatever, don't just sit and go, oh, well, I'll miss out, it doesn't matter. Do ask any one of us clergy or indeed church wardens or PCC members, and do encourage the question of what's happening now? When is this happening? What's happening here? Do ask the question, but without bombarding us. You may want to check the websites and Facebook pages first. The information will be given out, I'm sure, at some point when you need to know. But do ask if you feel like you've missed something. I hope that will be an encouragement to you. As I said, we're coming to the end of our service, so we're going to sing our final carol now. It's a great proclamation that we have as Christians to announce to the world. Joy, joy, joy. We're going to proclaim it from the rooftops that Christ is with us and that we can find him and see him, that he has been revealed to us, that the character of God has been found in Jesus Christ, and we as human beings can now know what he is like. So let us sing Joy to the World. So as we come to the end of our service, a final blessing and acclamation. May the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, the perseverance of the wise men, the obedience of Joseph and Mary, and the peace of the Christ child be yours this Christmas season. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all and remain with us now and always. Amen. The words for this liturgy will be on the screen. Let us bless the living God. He was born of the Virgin Mary, revealed in his glory, worshipped by the angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed in throughout the world, exalted to the highest heavens. Blessed be God, our strength and our salvation, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. I hope you have a good rest of your Christmas season and a very happy New Year celebration, however you celebrate that. God bless you and peace be with you this year and the next. Amen.